And for real, for me, it's really a pleasure to be here. Since I graduated with university, I think it's right now almost 15 years ago. So it's quite a long time. I turn a little bit from the electronics to telecommunication. So it is not so easy journey. And what I would like to discuss right now and what I've my thoughts about the telecommunication development. And question what I'm arising is the telecommunication development is stopping? So far, overall, on the telcos landscape, we have some kind of quite known Moore law that the transistors on the chip each 18 months double. So this is still valid, and this leads towards information growth. And the information growth, it's almost exponential. What we see right now, that within next 5 years, information what was sent via telecommunication networks will triple. So which means that we need a lot of bandwidth in our networks. And this growth looks even higher in not so mature markets, like Eastern Europe and Lithuania as well. So as you could see, average growth rate, it's something about 22 around the world. And in Lithuania, if you look on the future, it was 51%. On the other hand, we have another huge obstacle. It's that the prices and decrease. Overall, per minutes, per megabytes. And here you are quite luckily, here in Lithuania, we are the prices here in Lithuania is the lowest one in the Europe, in the telcos, both on the megabytes and both on the minutes. And somehow we need to deal with that to have the same revenue streams, despite, or it's not growing so much, and we have a lot of growth of the traffic. Another thing, what's changing with landscape is the OTT players, Google, Facebook. It's really hard right now to distinguish what is the real telco is. Is it a traditional voice, like call, or is it the Google Talk, Facebook chat, or Messenger, like Snapchat? So like now, with two worlds, telco and IT looks like converge. And with battle, it's not finalized yet. Who will be the main players on the market? Is it the OTT players will take over on the telco operators? I hope you know the projects like Google Fiber or like the Google Wi-Fi in Africa. So we are moving towards telco direction. On the same end, the telcos moving into the OTT players providing services for them. Another external factor is important, at least for the Europe here, we are talking about the digital agenda. Europe digital agenda, and in this statement was stated that by 2020, each citizen of the Europe should get the 30 megabits per second. So it looks at quite high speed on one hand. On another hand, EU pushing us to have no roaming prices, so this means that cost overall for the EU citizens will decrease. As I stated here, so far looks like telco didn't have any single service that belongs towards telco. Voice, messaging and stuff like that, it's now transparent across the board. If we look on the internal evolution on the telco landscape, I would like to mention that we have one of the most law what's stopping us It's a Shannon law in telcos. You know this, but that maximum bandwidth, maximum speed, what we would achieve on the channel is function on the bandwidth and signal to noise ratio. And we are limited on the spectrum. According to the ITU, the telcos to able to fulfill the market demands need at least 1 gigahertz spectrum overall. And it's quite huge comparing that right now we have something about 370, which was approved in the Radio Congress VRC 15 a few months ago. On our side, we see that the chips and power, what is on the processing power, is growing according to the Moore law, as I stated before. So this means its drives of electronics to be more flexible, more agile, and this drives into the virtualization direction. So let's see what the telcos access has. First of all, copper. We have it for more than 100 years right now. And as you see right now, we are almost reached the limit of the copper. 1 gigabit per second is a practically limit for the copper lines. But to reach that, you should be really close towards the customer. So it's tens of the meters towards the customer. So it's not, so the copper as an access layer looks like it is exhausted in the telco and we cannot use it anymore. So if we look on the radio side, it's the same. Shannon law works on the radio as well. So as you could see it, in the GSM technology, we could achieve something about 0.2 gigabits per hertz. It was 8 QPSK modulation, and by that time, the telco and electronics moves further, so when we get new modulation scheme, new amplifiers and stuff like that, which helps a bit. In the 4G, we are using 64.1. So it drives us to 0.8 in the maximum speed of 8 gigabits per hertz. Quite nice, I would say. In LTE technology, we increase it twice. Yeah, but what is important to state here? We are as well reaching the limits of the Shannon law. And according to the Qualcomm direction, this is the GPRS, this is the edge, sorry for the and here it's a 4G. So as you could see, this flat is it's slowing down. So this means that we are facing some quite big challenges. And the last one, fiber. So at least for now, it looks quite good. In the fibers, we are growing by 10 times each 4 years. And we still continue. So it looks like even if the standard single mode fiber was developed in 70s, so it looks like we are quite good in the fiber. But the maximum speed, theoretical speed, what we can achieve is 1 petabits per second. Which means that if we use the whole spectrum, 50 terahertz. Practically, on the existing systems, since the optical fiber was not developed. It was a standard, and it's not developed. Fiber itself, optical cable, was not developed enough. And the amplifier system, we use only 10 terabytes, 10 terahertz. And which means that we can have maximum something about 200 terabits per second. Are we close right now with that figure, do you know? Even in Lithuania, what we installed, it's 80 lambdas per 100 gigabit. So it's almost 1 terabyte. In the world, we have systems which working on 40 terabits per second. So as well, we are quite close to our Shannon law limitation. And somehow we need to breach that. So as you could see it, in the telcos, looks like in several areas, per single channel, we are reaching the limitation of the Shannon law. And somehow we need to overcome that. Now look a little bit on the future about the telco evolution, mobile telco evolution. So practically, each 10 years, technology change. In the 81, it was analog voice MNT communication. Then 2G, 92, voice as a first service, then SMS on 95, and we start on the GPRS, introduced the fixed data, but still it was based on the same same coding scheme. Then UMTS or 3G technology was introduced, and this was the first technology which has a two separation of the services. One for the voice, another is for the data. And really true converged network, which was provided in 2010, by the way, TeliaSonera was the first operator which launched the 4G as a commercial network in the 2010. And actually 1 year later, we launched it in Lithuania as well. So this is true true IP technology. Even voice is now transferred in the 4G as a voice over IP protocol. So, and what will be next one? So we are talking about the 10G in 2020. So, what on overall, what I would like to state here, the technology development in the telcos areas is not stopping. So how we are trying to overcome the Shannon law? So first of all, we are using more spectrum. So and the carrier aggregation is as a one technology, which allows the two frequencies combined together. As a one single channel was introduced. Now we're talking about the four carrier aggregation and stuff like that. And in 5G, it will be much more. What needs to be said on the standardization, this is, by the way, if you know this is the 3GPP standards, which drives the telco evolution, mobile telco evolution. And which standards releases each 1.5 year release the new standard, which leads to some development of the telcos, but more as well, it adds the complexity, how we are solving problems. Just for you to imagine, if we compare 2G standards and if we compare 4G standards, so it's something about more than 10 times documents is written. In the when it was invented 2G and when 3G standard was released, there was only three steps. It was introduced at SMS, and when introduces GPRS, and when introducing the edge. Now the between the 4G and 5G technology evolution goes much smoother. There will be not a big difference or no one single leap between the 4G and 5G. It will be a lot of steps which drives us from the existing 1 gigabit per link to 10 gigabit capacity. From 10 milliseconds, what we can achieve right now, to 1 millisecond, 1 millisecond delay. And what else is important things that even in 2G we are talk about the some kind of a measurement and Internet of Things, but it will be the huge steps in the 4G in the 5G, and I will talk a bit later on. So how it will change our society overall? So first of all, we are talking about the 30 or 50 megabits per second, and it's achievable, I would say, almost right now. In the 4.5G, we are talking about the smart meters, grids, in the cities and home, healthcare, it's already there, smart gadgets. But what is allows us to do that, it's massive MIMO, which means that instead of one radio link channel, we use it two in the 4G or 4x4 MIMO in the 4G, and in the 5G we are talking about the massive MIMO, like 64 channels, MIMO channels per one link. On the 5G we are talking about with tactical internet, which means that with the delay of 1 millisecond, you will not feel the difference if you control the car by steer or by a mobile network. Even cars can communicate directly with each other via our mobile networks. And this is future what we are building right now. Another thing, remote controls and machineries, machinery or industry revolution, what's called Industry 4.5, massive robots revolution, a lot of Internet of Things is coming here. And human and robots, of course, could coexist together. So, our market right now is under huge change. And which change leads by several components. First of all, the digitalization in everywhere. And in the 4G, we are talking that everyone is connected. In the 5G, we are talking that everything is connected. So this means we are switching from the humans to machines and boxes. So this is a quite huge steps in terms of it's, we can imagine how we are interacting with each other. It's hard to predict that someone not use the, in mobiles, in modern society didn't use the smartphones. So in next few years, we can hardly imagine that our gadgets is not connected towards the network. Oh, another thing what is important, that customers is more and more bandwidth hungry, persons. And what drives is, of course, is a video. Or we use the emails, in the beginning of the internet, we use the emails, then some kind of a chat, web, and stuff like that. Now more and more video or consumption is driven. We are talking about the SD, HD, or ultra high HD graphic, but as well virtual reality is coming, which will require more and more bandwidth. So we need to deal with that. And as well, as I said in the beginning, a lot of OTT players became part of the telco area. Or it's hard to distinguish where the telco begins and OTT player starts. So Google, Facebook, Netflix, and stuff like that. I could share one example from my company, Teo. So we have two TV services. One is broadcast, and another is video on demand, or it's recorded video. And what we see it right now, that broadcast subscription is going down, but tremendous growth, more than 20% per year is on the video on demand. So that people much more like to view the videos than we want, in which device we want, and it allows them to do it in quite flexible way. And as well, last but not least, which is related to my presentation, is the technology revolution. And what is mean with technology revolution? One thing is mean that in the internet we had everything connected like devices. Now in the 5G we are saying that everything will be connected, every device will be connected. According to the Moore law, the devices became smaller and more powerful, like smartphones. Now we are talking about the embedded chip and stuff like that, which drive the two things: virtualization on one hand. On another hand, we have a quite huge data channels, and this allows us, basically, we are starting to talk right now about the artificial intelligence. We have data centers with a quite powerful processing power, and we have almost real-time connection to everyone and everything. So, what about the 5G? And the 5G was developed slightly different than the 4G. And the reason for that, 4G was developed like internet, like the same service to everyone. So you could put any service on the 4G like it was on the internet. But in the 5G, we added service on top. So the network can distinguish the service itself and adopt network parameters to the service which is required. So we use one scheme if we have a broadband and we have a high data consumption. For example, if we need healthcare services, we don't need so much bandwidth, but it needs to be ultra reliable. On our hand, if we are talking about the Internet of Things, of course, then the power consumption is important. And this drives us that for each with services in the 3G GBP standardization, now we are developing the specific network parameters. So it's not like it was, as I said, it's not like before, the same service for everyone. Now the different service for different your service needs. Now, I'm talking a bit about the speed, and overall, in the last 10 years, in the telcos area, I'm more than 20 years, in the last 10 years, when the GPRS starts, the operators always compete with our by the speed. We achieve at 56 kilobits per second in the edge, or we receive at 180. To 56 kilobits in 3G started when we have finalized 3G with the 21 megabits with a high speed downlink packet. When 4G came, 100 megabits and stuff like that. And what I'm saying right now looks like the speed battle is as well slowing down. And the reason for that is that right now, in our, as a customers, we don't need so much speed. The most speed hungry application is, of course, is video. But look at the video. If we're talking about the even Ultra HD, it's 18 megabits per second. You could look at the, our regulator side, and our regulator measuring mobile operator speed. So I would say, in on average, Omnitel network was I remember it's providing 36 megabits to customer. Right now, in Lithuania. So this means that you could easily look even Ultra HD video on your mobile device. And Ultra HD video, it's still coming on the TV set. Personally, I'm commuting quite a lot from Kaunas to Vilnius. And during that time, sometimes when I'm not driving, I'm watching HD, YouTube in HD. And I didn't discover even single stops when I commuting 100 kilometers per hour. So video on demand, it's not so growing. So what is important from our understanding and what we are discovering, the delay is important even more than the data speed. In the 3G, the delays is something about from 50 to 100 milliseconds. And in the 4G, you're going down from 10 to 20 milliseconds. And actually, even when you're requesting web page, which means that there is a lot of interaction between your phone and server, which leads you that if you decrease your delays 5 times or 10 times, so you will get much, much better user experience even on the slower link, but with the low delays. We experience that even in our network. We launch a 4G in quite limited spectrum, each allows user to get only 5 megabits per second. But comparing with the 3G, which gets at 10 megabits per second, you have on the browsing, you have a better experience on the 4G. This is due to that delays is much lower. And of course, the user experience is driven by the combination of the factor. It's, of course, it's coverage. Without coverage, you cannot get any user experience. When it's at sufficient speed, and I would say it's something about above 20 megabits per second, then it's a delay. 10 milliseconds is enough right now. When we talk about the 5G, I think when we will talk about the 1 millisecond for the tactical internet. So I mentioned was speed delay and of course network reliability. So what is important towards customer? And what we have in Lithuania right now, in Lithuania we covered it by population is covered 99%. We have the LTE Advanced Pro. I will mention about this. And what we achieved actually right now. This year was released the 3GPP released the standard called LTE Advanced Pro. It adds 4 MIMOs, which means the 4 separate input output channel. It adds the 256 QAM modulation, which of course is better than the previous 64 QAM, and which allows us to combine the several several carriers. In this particular case, we combined 4 carriers, but there is a possibility to combine up to the 6 carriers, different carriers, which means different spectrum. This leads, or this allows us to reach 750 megabits per second. And it's in the live network. So as you could see it, the mobile and fiber capacity, what we can provide towards the customer, is almost the same. And by the way, latest Qualcomm chips, 820, support was LTE Advanced Pro release 13. So this means that newest phones has the possibility to achieve that speed. Only 4x4 MIMO is not implementing yet on the phones due to some kind of a quite tricky technology limitation. Yeah, one more thing, and I would say this is my request to you guys. I see in 5G that this will drive the electronic development a lot. And the reason for that we need to connect every device towards the network. So the standard will be released in July. So this means that in the this we have slightly different path than it was before in the before the 4G. As I said, one quite big step, and we are moving from a 3G to 4G. Between the 4G and 5G will be a lot of small steps, which allows us to make some kind of a small improvements and go towards the 5G. And one thing what is mentioned here is with Internet of Things. So what that we're talking about the Internet of Things, we are saying here that within something about 9 to 8 years should be something about 30 billion of the devices. We are talking about the billions of the smartphone right now, but within the 8 years we are talking about the at least 10 times more Internet of Things connected devices. And what industry are trying to achieve is to able to have with 30 billions of devices. First of all, we should have a quite long battery life. Right now we are talking about that from the one battery, the device should be suitable to work at least 10 years. Then device cost is important, and we are talking about the $5 per device. We are talking about the physical seamless devices. We are talking about the SIM will be embedded in the devices, and you need to just reprogram the SIM. Low cost of the deployments is important as well. And we are talking that the devices will have the updates on the year. We will work for the 10 year, quite low cost, so it's no need to maintain them. And the most thing, what is important as well, is the coverage. So in the IoT, cellular IoT, there is a several streams as well, depends on the application. We have one stream which allows us to use more bandwidth, like to up 1 gigabit, will be 100 megabits, but it will use more power and will not have low coverage. But in our areas where you really need just small proportion of data, we are talking about the tens of kilobits. But by doing that, it's only metering sensor or stuff like that, but doing that using the existing 2G spectrum, you could have a more gain. And if you have a 20 dB additional gain, you will have the full country coverage in the areas where there is no 2G coverage, where there is no 3G coverage, or there is no 4G coverage. So we are talking about the somewhere in the really deep buildings and stuff like that, that with IoT things can work. So and you could see it where with Internet of Things could be applicable. What I predict here, it will be more the same like we have with the apps. If you have a device which cost $5, so and it will be standardized, so every one of you could develop and install, imagine, tens of the devices, and which application will fly, no one knows. But if you find was a really good, it's like the Angry Birds. No one knows. It's just develop the application and it's flies over over the market. The same will be with the IoT of things. We don't know what it will fly. Is it the dog tracking, or is some kind of a gas metering, or is I don't know, something in the IoT on your fridge or in the car. But this allows us here to test a lot of devices, and it will not be a huge cost. So this means that everyone who has at least quite small knowledge in the electronics and in the IT then could build its own Internet of Things. So one more challenge, what we are overcoming here is of course the fixed and mobile convergence. Last year, here in Lithuania, we merged mobility and telco operator was merged into one. And this is the same trend going across the world right now. And the reason for that is that we are not talking about the technology fixed or mobile. Now we are converging with the services. We are talking about the same services that are agnostic from the access networks. And what application allows us to do that? First of all, is the core network. It's IP multimedia subsystem. It's called the EMS. It's developed for a quite long time. But this allows us in the telcos to have the same service on the Wi-Fi, 4G, on the broadband, I don't know, or on fiber link. So it's no different. Are you fixed or mobile subscriber? You could have the same network. On other hand, to deal with the with challenges, we are talking about the how to gain from the economy of scale. Because, as I mentioned, the standards and systems became more and more complex. So, and we revenues is not growing up. So somehow we need to reduce the cost. And one of the cost reduction drivers or trend in the world is virtualization. It came into the IT area, and now it's coming towards the telcos. EMS was a first, core network, which was designed to put on the virtualization platform. When we are talking about the virtual evolved packet core, Cloud RAN versus RAN versus radio access network. We are talking about the Cloud RAN that you have only one, several brains, in for example in the cities, and then radio unit are connected towards fiber. By doing that, you achieving because you can coordinate activities between the different RAN devices from the same. Same central unit, you could achieve the lower noise or interference to each other, and this means higher speed towards the customer. So, to conclude, is telco development stopped? No, it's still growing, despite the Shannon law. We are still solving challenges, adapting, and surviving. We are like a living animal, according to the Darwin. So we are growing on the capacities. We see challenges on the access, but we know how to overcome them. Basically, when we are reaching the channel limitation on one channel, we just adding higher spectrum, adding additional channels. So this is how we are overcoming the Shannon law. And in 5G, challenges will be solved by more spectrum, massive MIMO, intelligent virtualization, and convergence. And revenues from GDP, revenues from telco seems stable. We are successful competing with the OTT players, and we are growing in adjacent areas. Like Telia Sonera grow adjacent in the Spotify, moving towards Spotify. We are moving towards IT, cloud virtualization. And to say, to finalize my presentation, I could say, it's really worth be part of the telco development in our world. Thank you.
Maybe questions?
Thank you all very much. Interesting presentation. I was wondering about the protocol level, especially in Internet of Things. Do you expect IP6 to take over of the largest part of this network, or it will stay as much heterogeneous as it now, variety of local and even proprietary networks which connects these IoT sensors? Or IP6 will take what you think?
Definitely IP6 will come into Internet of Things if you need worldwide connectivity. The challenges on the Internet of Things, of course, will be on the security and privacy, and this is not solved yet. So this is Andrews, I think, talked in the last electronic conference about the security law. So definitely, I see that IPv6 will come here, but we need to solve the privacy and security issues.
Okay. No more questions. Thank you very much. And as a tradition, a small souvenir for our presenter. Thank you very much.